This is Coogan Cassis for Rifle TV in association with Macklin's Jim Marbar. With me, I'm joined by Matthew Macklin. How are you, sir?
Yeah, not bad, not bad, Coogs.
A lot going on at the moment for you, Matt, and the gym and sort of your managerial side of things now. First of all, you've been out of the ring for a while now, and you're quite content with that?
Yeah, very much so. Like I said a few times before, I think looking back now, you can always lock the pieces together looking backwards, but it's hard moving forward. But looking back, I think probably, certainly after Highland, I was going to retire after the last Highland in Ireland. It'd been a funny year for me. I'd been out of the gym. I hadn't been out of the gym. There was a talk of the Sturm rematch. Then the Gill fight was happening. I trained hard for it. That got pulled like 2 weeks before. Then I was back in the gym. I was meant to fight in the August. I had the thing with Jamie Moore in Spain. Then the fight got put back. I ended up boxing in Germany. Done an 8-rounder there. Then I did fight Highland. By the time I fought him, I just felt I'd been burnt out. So, you know, that niggled me a little bit, but you know, for all intents and purposes, I'd retired that night. Definitely retired in my heart. But I think for the sake of closure, I carried on. There was talk of a Danny Jack possibility of fighting Danny Jacobs for the world title shot. And I thought, well, look, you know, I'll go all in. If I win, I'll keep going. If I lose, at least I'll go out in the world title shot. That never materialised. But, you know, it kind of got me thinking again. It got me thinking, well, you never know. I'll get myself going, get a few wins together, and we'll see what comes. And I put a 4-fight winning streak together, with the last one being Brian Rose. But I probably knew training for that fight, I definitely knew within that fight, I think after a few rounds, that I didn't want to do it anymore. And looking back now, I think that I probably started losing the love and the passion and the drive for it bit by bit, probably post-Martinez. I think building up to the, you know, the Sturm fight, it was a long career, slow burning at times, a lot of ups and downs, a lot of injuries, a lot of periods of inactivity, changing trainers, changing promoters, managers, and you know, it's like walking around cities that you're not from, you know, doing a pub crawl of Starbucks, you know what I mean, and talking to yourself and just visualising and thinking and waiting on a phone call. It takes a lot, it's a big commitment, and it takes a lot of, you know, ambition and drive to keep that going. And I think, you know, after so many years, I think probably after Martinez, I'd done all right at the sport then. I'd fought for the world title a couple of times. I felt I'd won it against Sturm, didn't get it, gone close to Martinez. And then, you know, I still thought I can recapture that form. And I don't think, when I say recapture the form, I don't think it was, you know, I got old overnight or anything like that. Like, I think I was still, still had the win against Alcim. It was a good first round knockout. You know, and even coming back after that. But I just think, and I think losing Golovkin was special. I'm my best ever night. I don't think I'd have beaten Golovkin. But I just think, you know, it was bit by bit, probably after Martinez fight, I probably started losing the desire for it a little bit. But, you know, back in the managerial side of things now, you know, MGM, you know, as a company, we've got really going places. We're working really well with Frank Warren, Eddie Hearn. You know, I had a great relationship with Eddie at the end of my career. Had a really good relationship with Frank Warren, you know, at various points of my career, turned pro with him. I was with him a couple of times after that. We've got a lot of fighters with both guys now, and there's not many management companies or managers in the sport that can say that, certainly in the UK. You know, and even now with Condon signing with Top Rank, you know, I fought with DiBello myself, had a good relationship with Lou DiBello. I was speaking to him the other day, looking to maybe put a couple of fighters with him. You know, Robert Diaz at Golden Boy, who's, you know, probably number two or three at Golden Boy, a personal friend of mine. I don't think there's anyone in boxing, any management company or any managers that have probably, you know, worked so well with everyone and aren't biased or, you know, sort of only loyal to one person. We work as a company, we work with everyone, and I don't think there's many management companies that can say that.
I mean, over the last few years, while the sort of the rise of your gym, Macklin's Gym, Marbar, where you've been fighting as well as that company, the sort of the rise of that company as well, it must have been obviously difficult for you to kind of focus on the gym side of it, because you were still an active fighter, but now you're not an active fighter. You know, you can sort of put all your resources, all your attention, all your time into pushing your company.
Yeah, very much so. I mean, it's like if I'm waiting on a phone call or I'm negotiating for my fight, for a particular person, one of my fights, but I need to speak to that promoter about Joe or John or whoever, it's like, if I ring him, is he going to think that I'm kind of like weakening my position in my own negotiation? But then how do I speak on behalf of them? So you're caught between, it's a conflict of interest almost. You're still fighting yourself. and you're representing people. But I mean, so there was, I mean, like I said, there was, you know, MGM's not just me. It's a company. There's, you know, with about staff. It's and it's it works well that way. And I am a lot more actively involved now than I was when I was fighting, because I can be. I have the time. I have the energy. I don't. I'm not sort of got one arm tied behind my back because I've got my own goals or my own sort of, you know, agendas in my own career. I'm like, you know, I'm very much focused on what's best for our fighters. You know, it's not about me. My career's been undone. It's over. So, you know, I just want to do now, and I just want to pass on the best wisdom or the best experience and knowledge that I've gained in my career, and to help other fighters coming through.
Now, the biggest thing that's coming up sort of in the very near future is going to be the rebranding of Macklin's Gym Marbella. Well, I want you to explain to me, I already know obviously, but explain to the people what the situation with that and why you have to rebrand and more specifically rename.
Yeah, well, I'll take you back to the very start of MGM, how it all started. You know, I just got fed up really of living out of the bag, training. I think it was for the Martinez fight. We were down in Battery Park, me and Seamus. It was freezing cold. Been there for 10 weeks. You know, it was a long time just on your own. And, you know, it was, like I said, it was freezing cold. It really dragged out. And I just thought, you know what? After this fight, win, lose, or draw, I'm not gonna do this again. You know, I'm in a stage now. I'm earning good money for the fights. You know, I can bring the sparring in. You know, I'll be paying. I mean, big fights. I'll be paying the trainer good money. You know, he can come over to me. So we thought, you know, at that stage for several years before that, all my downtime in between fights, I've been spending it in Marbella really. And I thought, you know what? Why not go there? It's great, great weather. You know, great hills for running. You know, lovely climate. Like I say, let's do it. That makes most sense. And I just thought of like maybe rent, you know, paying to use a gym, and then it just snowballed into, well, let's get our own gym. And it was like, well, let's get our own gym here. I want to get it a bit bigger, and it just went, just snowballed and snowballed. And then we went from, say, let's manage like 3 or 4 fighters to, like, I think we've got nearly 100 now, or over 100. So it's like, you know, it really has snowballed and progressed. And we actually joked when we said, well, what we call it, Macklin's Gym. And what's Macklin's Gym? Well, we'll call it Macklin's Gym Marbella. It's in Marbella. And we'll call it MGM. And then when we joked, we said, oh, no, we'll never get away with that. The MGM in Las Vegas will definitely sue us over that for likeness of the trademark or whatever. And they were like, nah, they won't. I go, nah, I don't know. If we get big enough, they will. And they said, well, if they sue us, we know we've smashed it. If we get to the stage where the MGM casino in Las Vegas have heard about us, then we know we achieved more than our wildest dreams. We definitely achieved a massive accomplishment. And so I think, you know, only 4 years going now, just over 4 years, to say that that's happened, then I think that's a testimony to how far we've come in 4 years. And I mean, and in fairness, we didn't just put down without a fight. That we pushed back on them. They wanted to get rid of everything, but, you know, after back and forth for the last probably best part of 6 months now, we've agreed that we can keep all the logo, keep the colours, but obviously the initials have to change because, you know, MGM is very synonymous with their company in Las Vegas, and it would be, I think, you know, we would lose if we went to argue over the likeness of the trademark. So we decided to rebrand it. We changed. We keep the logo, keep the colours, but instead of it being called MGM, Macklin's Gym Management, Macklin's Gym Marbella, it's now going to be called MTK, Mac the Knife Promotions, Mac the Knife Management.
Your old fighting name.
My old fighting name. So because we were thinking at first, well, what should we call it now? And we did want to keep the logo because it's very established. It's very out there. It's very known with our company and all the fighters that we manage. So so MTK for me was, you know, we were thinking around what should we do, but it was probably the most logical. You know, it's like I said, it was my ring name, it's my nickname, Mac the Knife, and MTK kind of, yeah, it has a nice ring to it.
Do you want to just give us a little sneak preview?
So, like I say,
what it'll look like now?
It's still very much the same colours, the same logo, which was important because, you know, a lot of work, a lot of money, everything's gone into it, and it's you know, it's very, everyone knows it, it's established, so it represents us, it's very synonymous with us. So it's okay, the initials have had to change, the name of the company has had to change, but it's everyone knows that that's the same, we're the same people that were behind MGM. It's not MGM now, it's MTK, but it's the same group.
Yeah. I suppose it's one of these things within, you know, 6 months to a year, you know, the whole, people are not used to it at the moment, but you'll get to a point, I've said between 6 months and a year, where people are just, are used to sort of that end. Because MGM now is, I think, especially in England, where, you know, the majority of your boxers are, they hear MGM. They don't really associate MGM with the casino. They associate it with your gym. So, you know, like I said, within a year, MTK will have just replaced that, and that'll be in people's heads.
It changes any brand. Or if you think, look at anything, it always, I don't know, if it's a... You've got a friend that gets married, and you know her by a maiden name, and then she gets married. You know, it takes to some people, it's always the maiden name, and it'll never change. But generally, most people, that it'll just, they just change, you know. And you know, what's Posh Boyce? Victoria Beckham. Yeah. No one calls her Victoria Adams anymore.
No.
You know, you get used to it. It can take a while for some people, but like you say, 6 months, a year, it'll be MTK. And where we're going to go, I think, like any business or any... You know, anything that, any project that you're pushing forward, getting going initially is always the hardest. Where I think, because we're established now, it'll go from strength to strength. You know, like I said, we're working with everyone in the sport. I just think that, you know, MTK, before it won't be long, and it'll be MGM, everyone just knows MTK because it's just a natural progression. It's a natural change. They'll know who it is, everything. They know it's the same people. Nothing's changed really. Just the rebranding. It's as simple as that.
You talk about your team, obviously, while you're fighting, you had to sort of let people within MGM, MTK, do their job, and sort of people that you trust, people that you can, you know, rely on. Talk to me a little bit about your sort of, I'm not going to call them your staff because you're a team, so your partners within MGM. Talk to me a little bit about who's pivotal to what.
Yeah, well, like I say, I'm not... definitely not staff. It's like I say, it's a group, and everyone's, you know, equal. Like I said, me and Daniel started off MGM. We're best friends. I was over there all the time when I was training, and I just thought, after my tennis fight, I was like, you know, let's set a gym up here. I'm coming over here all the time, in between my fights. You know, maybe being here, in between and during, will keep me more settled, and obviously the warm weather and everything else. So. And that's what the idea was born out of, just that really. And then, so we set that up and it just grew. But, you know, obviously then there's been a lot of bad publicity, and obviously the thing with the way, what happened with the weigh-in and Jamie Morse. Daniel took a backward step. He still advises lots of fighters, Billy Joe Saunders, for example. You know, Daniel has a lot more contact with Billy Joe than I do. He took a backward step. Sam Kine looks very much in now, kind of running things day to day. Anthony Fitzpatrick, you know, runs the gym in Marbella, and he's very hands on, you know, with the daily running of everything. We've also got other staff now, bringing more and more in all the time as we're growing. So, you know, Seamus is obviously out here in New York with me. I'm going to be managing Michael Conlon, so we're going to really push him on a ground level here. So, like I say, yeah, MGM, MTK now is a. Is a lot much big. Is much more bigger than me. It's not just me at all. And I don't view any of them as my staff. It's a group really, all working together.
I mean, I go back from 2 years ago or two, say 3 years ago, when obviously you started sponsoring us, IFL TV, and there wasn't that many boxers that were sort of on your books as, you know, box fighters that you managed, but. I mean, 3 years on, and the amount and the sort of levels of fighters that you're signing is quite phenomenal. From, you know, and it seems like everyone kind of wants to be a part of MGM, MTK. They want to be a part of it. They want to, you know, be representing your company. That must, you know, make you proud to see that what you've sort of started, and it's just growing from day to day.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I don't think there's another management company like it in boxing. There's, I mean, you got some big managers over here in the States, you know, Cameron Duncan, Shelley Finkel back in the day. They were powerful management managers. They would have had a lot of the big fighters, and they probably were more of a, they probably weren't hands on with every single fighter because they had so many, you know, but they had clout. That so maybe an individual person can give a boxer can probably answer 10 phone calls a day, but they wouldn't have had the same clout of a Shelley Finkel or a Cameron Duncan with these bigger promoters, so they can always get you a better deal than a smaller manager couldn't. And I think the way our company has grown and the way it's so strong now across the board, we feel we can get a better deal for our fighters than anyone else can. And, you know, that, you know, the proof's in the pudding, and we do seem to be doing that. And I think fighters talk to fighters. It's a small world in the boxing world. Everyone knows everyone, really, or they know someone who knows someone. And by word of mouth and by what they see on the television and what they read and see, we are doing the best for our fighters that we represent. Anyone that's with us, we go above and beyond for, you know, it's about helping these kids achieve their dreams and get making the most money they can to secure their own futures. And, you know, we that's what we pride ourselves in, and that's what we're looking to achieve.
People within boxing more sort of more aware, shall we say, of the politics, which is, it can be great, but it can be horrible as well. But you kind of sit there between, you know, the likes of Frank Warren and Eddie Hearn, who, you know, it's no secret, and not, even though they've never met, they're not the best of friends, but it doesn't really affect your position, because if you're working with one, you're working with them. If you're working with the other, you're working with them. There's no reasons why, really, that doesn't work for you to sort of have some of your fighters with Frank, some of your fighters with Eddie, if that be the case.
Well, that's it. I mean, we're just not interested in the politics of fights not getting made or anyone's career being held back because they're not with this one or that one. You know, we just want to do the best for our fighters. And, you know, on a long career, you know, like I said, I was with different trainers, different managers, different promoters. You know, I was, you know, I turned professional with Frank Warren. You know, I was with him two other times after that. You know, I was out in Dallas when Liam Smith fought, and we had dinner, and that, I like Frank Warren. I've got a lot of respect for him. I get on very well with him. I think what he's done for British boxing over the years, he's probably the best promoter outside of America. He's in the Hall of Fame, you know, 30 odd years, you know, he's reinventing himself, gone from BBC to ITV, ITV to Sky Sports, he's gone to Satanta, back to Sky Sports. You know, he's really, you have to respect the man. And I get on very well with him. The MGM as a group get on very well with him. Lots of fighters that we manage have boxed on shows with Frank's that are promoted by Frank. MGM even done some Box Nation dates with Frank. You know, Eddie Hearn, I think, you know, I didn't know Eddie till but later on in my career. And the last couple of years, last 18 months or so, I was with Eddie. God, I'm great with Eddie. You know, and I'm on to Eddie most days, making matches for different fighters. And, you know, we've been out in Vegas, and socially we've had a drink, or we've gone out, or we've had a, you know, we've shared dinner or whatever. And he's a good guy, and I got very well with him, very transparent. And he's a pleasure to deal with. Lou DiBella, I was with for a few years. You know, like I say, Michael Conlon signed with Top Rank. Robert Diaz with Golden Boy, a personal friend of mine. So we're not in, people fall in and fall out in boxing. It's a funny old game, and it's an even funnier business. And, you know, oh, you can't be friends with them, and you can't be friends with us. But we're not interested in that. We don't want to get into that. Everyone can't get on with everyone all the time. But what we can do is do the best for our fighters. And if that means the best deal for them is with Frank Warren, then that's the best deal for them. If the best deal for them is with Eddie Hearn, then the best deal for them is with Eddie Hearn, and that's what we'll do. And we're not interested in getting caught up in politics. We just want to do the best we can do for the fighters that we represent.
The quality of fighters you're signing seems to be improving. I mean, you have fighters between sort of MGM Scotland, Liverpool, Manchester, Birmingham, fighters on all different kind of levels, but the level of fighters are seem to be stepping up from, you know, a couple of years ago now. The likes of Billy Joe Saunders, Liam Smith, and, you know, David Price, Michael Conlon now, Paddy Barnes. So there's no real sort of benchmark to how high you can go.
No, but if you want to get into the property business, developing property, but you haven't got any money, or you haven't got a staff, or you haven't got anything, you're probably just going to buy one house first. And then you might buy a second and third, and before you know it, you're buying plots of land and developing, you know, a house, a housing estate, maybe a shopping centre. You know, that's, things grow, and you know, you have to be in it to win it, and you got to get going in something. And, you know, initially, we just started the gym. There was, like, I think it was Seamus and Michael Rooney was the first NGEM fighter. Yeah. You know, and then you had guys like Peter McDonough come over for sparring, Bradley Saunders, you know, and it just grew and grew and grew. And like you say, now, you know, like guys like fighters like Liam Smith, who are world champions, Billy Joe Saunders, world champion, you know, and it's just gone from strength to strength, to the extent that now we've signed a kid coming out of the Olympics, Michael Conlan, to the biggest deal that any Irish amateur boxer has ever signed, with Top Rank, the biggest promoters in world boxing, who have brought through more champions and superstars than anyone. You know, Floyd Mayweather, Oscar De La Hoya, you know, Miguel Cotto, Felix Trinidad, you know, he promoted Muhammad Ali, you know, or he owns all the rights to those Hagler Hearns fights and all them. You know, he's the biggest in the sport, and, you know, probably the most sought after amateur out of the Rio Olympics, certainly from an Irish or a UK element, was Michael Conlan. And he signed with us, a long term management deal with us, his brother's with us, his friends, Tyron McKenna, are all with us. And he's seen how well they've been looked after and how hard we work for them and the opportunities that we create for them. And, you know, Michael signed a great deal with Top Rank. He's making his professional debut on Paddy's Day, St. Patrick's Day, March 17th, Madison Square Garden. Talk about a fairy tale debut. I mean, it's what dreams are made of. And it's like, you know, they're absolutely behind him and they feel that he's going to be built into a pay-per-view star. And to go in 4 years, I remember when I first seen Michael Conlan when we were still finishing work at the gym. Well, I was training in there. I was training for Alcine. Buddy McGirt was in Spain and we were training in the gym. All we had up was the ring, a couple of bags, and the showers were working. It was still very much being done. And we opened it then the end of September, so probably, you know, 6 weeks later or so. But I remember watching Conlan in the Olympics thinking that kid could be special. And 4 years on, he signed with us. So that tells you where we've gone from opening the gym, where you just had a shower and a ring and a couple of bags in it, to now that kid that's won a bronze medal in the Olympics for Ireland in the London Olympics, and then got robbed in Rio, but has now signed with Top Rank and is making a professional debut on St. Patrick's Day. That shows you how far it's come. And now we're rebranding because the MGM Casino in Las Vegas aren't happy because of the likeness. And we fought with them, we fought the good fight, and we kept the colours and we kept the logo. And now, you know, as a group now, it won't be MGM, it'll be MTK.
So, I mean, moving forward with you, I mean, I'm assuming you're always sort of looking, not maybe actively looking, but, you know, in regards to fighters signing with you, what specifically do you look for? What does it take to sort of cut it as an MTK, MGM fighter? What kind of fighters do you want to work with moving forward?
Well, you know, we want to work with good fighters, but we want to work with good people as well. You know, there's someone that's going to be a good fighter, but he's going to be a prima donna, egomaniac, me, self-obsessed, all about him, and he's just going to be difficult to deal with and he's going to be headaches, then we don't care if he's the next Floyd Mayweather. We're not interested. You know, every personality, everyone's not the same, and everyone, some people are quiet, some people are very brash, but you have to be a good person, you have to be easy to deal with, you have to be enjoyable to work with, because if you're not enjoying it, what's the point? You know, yeah, it's a business and it's you know, boxing's a sport and a business and we love it. But if you're not enjoying working with the people you're with, then there's no point. So, yeah, we want good fighters, but we want good people. And like I said, I'm not stipulating what personality they have to be, but they have to be enjoyable to work with.
I mean, is this what you're doing now? Is it, I'm not saying you was kind of fucked in your career with contracts, money, etc., but you kind of probably know every trick in the book that a promoter would pull, or any sort of contract thing. Mm. So you're aware of that. So that probably puts you in a good position to be making sure that doesn't happen to your fighters.
Yeah, I mean, in many ways, I wish when I was 18, 19, I could have had someone like me now. You know, that I trusted, and not that I just trusted, but I trusted their competence. You know, we've all got people we trust, because you know, they'd never rob us or they'd never see us wrong. But do we trust their ability, their competence within the sport, their knowledge of the game? Chances are probably not. because we, you know, where you're coming from, whatever, you just don't know people in the sport that far into it already. So, you know, you're relying on your dad or your brother or an uncle or someone that, yeah, of course you trust them with your life, but what do they know about boxing and the business of boxing, really? So, you know, I think the experience I've picked up along the way, I wish I knew it all then. I wish I knew then what I knew now, which probably every fighter could say. You know, the different trainers I've moved with, and that probably lack of stability, that lack of continuity, lack of momentum, probably meant I underachieved. But if me underachieving a little bit means I can help every lad that we're with achieve their potential, you know, and please God, even overachieve, then I'll take positives out of that.
So you kind of, I'm not sure you had the vision 4 years ago to know exactly where you would be in 4 years' time. You probably didn't expect it to have come this far, and you've been so involved in the current boxing scene. But if you could say in the next 2 years from now, so 2019, where ideally would you like you and your company to be?
Well, I mean, so I think in the UK, there's we most fighters want to sign with us. Ireland, we've got, you know, pretty much all the top fighters now, really. And I think now with Conlon being based here in America, promoted here in America, you know, me and Shane's going to be out here pushing him on that ground level. Ludi Bella, like I was speaking the other day about possibly, you know, John O'Carroll, Ray Mollet. And, you know, there's a few guys there, Phil Sutherland, there's a lot of fighters there that could maybe, you know, we'll have to see where they are with their own contracts and different things. But there's a big, big market for Irish fighters on the East Coast of America. So New York, Boston, Philadelphia, you know, there's a real boxing audience there for Irish fighters. And that's something we'd like to kind of get into. And like we're kind of now boxing on Paddy's Day, that'll be huge. But we'd like to see a few more fighters come following his footsteps.
And Paddy Barnes is also on that bill?
Not sure yet. I don't think so. No, I think Paddy will be boxing probably in Belfast, February 18th. So no, I think it'll be just all about St. Patrick's. That'll be all about Michael Conlon, his professional debut in the start of what I think will be a very special career.
Yeah, I mean, everyone's excited to see what Michael Conlon can do in the pro game. Like I said, it was a disappointing Olympics for him, but that's kind of behind him now, so pushing forward, everyone's very eager to see what he can do in the ring, the pro game.
Everyone excited about Michael Conlon, and listen, everyone's excited about Paddy Barnes and Jamie Conlon and everyone else as well. You know, I mean, Belfast has sort of really sort of, you know, I think MJ's been a massive shot in the arm for boxing in Belfast. It's given them the outlet to show their skills, to box at home, to build their fan base. The last show there was a brilliant show. In Belfast, you know, Phil Sutcliffe Jr. against Jenkins from Wales. What a great fight that was! And it was exactly the type of fight that Phil Sutcliffe needed at this stage in his career. You know, he's been hearing for a lot of years how, you know, how hard still Phil punches, how good of a fighter he could be, and he's been plagued with injuries. But he needed a really competitive fight, a tough fight that'd bring the best out in him. And you know, for him to win that fight in Belfast on television, you know, it's really given his career a shot in the arm, and you know, it was great to see. And we want to see the likes of Tyrone McKenna stepping up now, fighting for titles this year. You know, Paddy Barnes, we believe, can be very much fast tracked. You know, he's 30 years old, he's 3-time Olympian, massive amateur pedigree. You're talking probably 6-7 fights, 8 fights, and he can be fighting for a world title. So, yeah, all the fighters are moving, but Michael Conlon, of course. He's a standout fighter, and you know, the deal he did with Top Rank was huge, and they have massive plans for him. They really want to build him into a big pay-per-view star here in America. But you know, he will fight at home as well at least once a year, so that'll be exciting when Michael Conlon goes back to Belfast too.
Okay, well, Matthew, unless you've got anything else you'd like to add about anything,
just that, listen, MGM, it's been brilliant the last 4 years, and you know, it's the same people, the same company, everything's only going from strength to strength, but it's not MGM anymore, it's MTK, McDonough Management, McDonough Promotions, and like I say, it'll be MTK before you know it, and we're just looking forward to the future and keep moving and keep expanding, and like I say, there was even the gyms in Johannesburg You know, there's people in Thailand that want to come under the banner of MTK now. So, yeah, it's just things are getting exciting all the time.
And also, you're also launching kind of an MTK London as well, where you're going to be doing a series of shows in Essex as well. So, branching out to over my way, Matt.
Yeah, let's see if we can get you in the ring, Coogs. Let's get you on a white collar or something. You and James can fight.
Don't know about that.
Definitely got
that.
The reach on him.
All right, well, listen, Matthew, thank you very much for talking to IFL TV. Good to catch up with you, and lots of good to... Well, it's not much, you know, more of an update, really, about where your situation is at the moment. So, like I said, MTK, it will be sooner rather than later.
MTK, like STK, the Steakhouse. So it would be MTK, STK.
But yeah, like I said, by the end of this year, that will kind of, MGM will be MGM will have their name back, so people will refer to MGM as the hotel. So, yeah, but listen, we'll catch up with you soon, and you'll be out here, so.
So look forward to the big fights when you get you or James or whoever comes over. Looking forward to it.
I think we're both going to come over for Conlon.
That's a weekend not to be missed.
Definitely. All right, this is Coogan Cassis with Matthew Macklin for IFL TV. Thank you very much.